Welcome to the Hero Escape Podcast, your weekly escape from a world where James Gunn got fired, but somehow Bryan Singer still has a job. I am one of your three co-hosts, Social Justice Misfire, and I am joined by...
Is it me? That's
what I go. Speechless? Is that your name? I'm joined by Speechless.
Speechless Bobblehead. That actually would be a good name.
Oh!
Can I just use that one?
Keep yes.
Speechless Bobblehead. All right, Speechless. And in honor of the show I missed, Mission Impossible Pumpkin Spice, and in honor of the great Simon Pegg, I am his brother, Taken Downa, because clearly you guys rocked it without me.
I had to think about that for a minute. Taken down, Peg. Well played.
So it's great to be back.
Very nice.
Yes, great to be back. I had that plan since listening to that episode. Yes.
Oh, I've been brewing in there.
Yes, yes. It's festered nicely. But I am humbly yours, Taken Downa. And anyways, recap. We've all been on vacation for a while. It's time to get back. And just like when you get back to your regular job, your inbox is full. All the things you didn't go, it almost feels like it wasn't vacation. Our inboxes are full. There's so much nerdery to get to. We're just going to start rifling through our inbox as best we can. There's lots of things we're excited to talk about. Nathaniel.
I have a 12-year-long habit of a game called World of Warcraft.
And what's it called again? World of, what is it again?
World of Warcraft. World of Obsession Craft.
I'll have to look, Google this.
Hi, game. Nathaniel. Yeah. Wait.
Somehow, all these years, this game just keeps sucking me in. I quit for a while, and then it pulls me back in.
This looks like an AA meeting right now.
Oh, it's so bad. It's so bad. But
it
they just released
right back in.
A new expansion pack called Battle for Azeroth. And I read an article that it is the fastest selling of all the expansion packs they've done. And they've released like 5 or 7 now.
So is there any World of Warcraft fatigue? The world's getting too much Warcraft?
I don't think so.
Oh, so that's still not a thing. Okay,
I think
ahead.
People Continue. Do experience fatigue, but even I have heard that. I read an article just the other day that some guy who hasn't played in 10 years went back for a battle.
Yeah.
And is it of or for Azeroth?
For Azeroth.
Battle for Azeroth. Okay.
So if you keep releasing good product, people don't get tired of it? Huh. Okay.
Not
sorry.
Only that. This is what I really want to talk about here.
Sorry.
Let's get to
By
it.
By the end
Tell
of the
us
first
what you
day,
want, what you really, really want.
Okay, so. They sold 3.4 million copies.
Wow.
By the time day one closed out.
Holy That's cow.
So the lowest price you could pay, because there's collector's editions and all that, is $50, right?
Oh, my God.
So I did a little quick math. That means $170 million.
In one day. Not like an opening weekend for a movie. That's one day, 24 hours.
They right? may be counting like the pre-orders leading up to, but when the game launched, 3.4 million people, like that person you mentioned, came back for it.
So you know what that means, right? There's going to be another one.
I don't know. I think they're probably like, guys, this pile of money's getting a little high.
Yeah.
I'm starting to get a little
Well, that's
like,
good news. Awesome.
And, I mean, how many of their Scrooge McDuck-style money bins can they build, right? Yeah.
So this game still charges $15 a month to be able to play it.
Oh, wow.
So those 3.4 million people also had to renew their subscriptions at $15 on top of that $50, which is another $51 million.
So it was the first summer was 170 something?
170, 51 million, total 221 million.
Wow, that's insane.
That's an absurd amount of money.
Yeah.
And the 51 million, if they keep everybody engaged, is month after,
after
month,
month after month, month
after month. Month. Yeah. It's crazy.
So why bother making another movie when you can just make another game and it's guaranteed money?
It's crazy. Anyway, really, this was just a big roundabout way for me to justify my habit. So I just wanted to share that with everybody.
Completely non-addictive, healthy habit that you have.
Yeah. I haven't been staying up past midnight every day this week. Not at all.
So what is it that keeps bringing you, that sucks you back in every time?
It is the story, hands down.
Yeah?
And what has happened is this game launched in 2004 and they had limited tools to tell the story and then computer graphics get better and their engines get better and they get better tools to solve the story. And now if anybody's interested and you go on YouTube and you look up the Battle for Azeroth cinematic, the quality level is on par with any movie you've seen. It's unbelievable now. How far
have video games come? I mean,
oh yeah.
I mean, Super Mario Brothers came out when I got Nintendo and like, we never even beat the game, but those who did, they're like, oh, there's a princess? Like, I was just jumping and breaking things for as long as I could and fighting this dragon. Like, oh, there's a story. We're saving a princess. And here, so like the story was almost irrelevant. Like, I'm playing a game with a computer, you know? Yes. And here you are like living a movie in games now, right? Like, yeah. You got me to play the, what's his name?
Uncharted
games. Yeah. And like, it's like you're acting out a movie in these games. It's like so amazing really now. The story. Yeah. That's cool.
Kids can be, these days are so spoiled.
And I will say, Warcraft games are really just, to me, it's that real-time strategy. I guess the old ones are real-time strategy games.
Right.
And those are just, the thought level they put into it is just, it's just a super fun game. I am a cheapskate, so I don't want to pay $15 a month for a game, so I don't play World of Warcraft, but I still have Warcraft 3. It still runs good on just about any computer. So I like maybe once every other year, I load it up on something and play through all of it. And then the expansion, the Lich King, I think is what it's called.
The Frozen Throne?
Frozen Throne, yeah. It's where you become.
Yeah, you showed me it, yeah.
And anyway, they're still super fun. I still love them. And my son now plays them and loves them. They're just. It's just a fun game.
Is it just me when you have this good story, the video game goes from a fun distraction to. Better escapism, right?
Oh man, that's the problem.
Where you can deep dive into it, right?
Yeah. Because I bought the collector's edition. It came with two little mini novels.
Holy
cow! Give you more of the story to read, and then there's a full novel that we also got from the library, and that gives you more. And it's just like you can fall as far down that rabbit hole as you want.
Are you confessing this because you want us to maybe throw you a lifeline sometime, or just know where you disappear to?
I need an intervention.
Okay.
This is the time. Yeah, so that's been consuming a lot of my time. But there's been a lot of other crazy stuff. I don't know if you guys heard or not, but the merger between Disney and 21st Century Fox got approved by the shareholders. It is official. So the actual ink's going to go on the paper and it'll be official at the beginning of 2019. But the final number, you remember all that bidding that went back and forth? It started like in the 50s or something like that. It ended at $71.3 billion.
That's insane. That's so much
money.
Yeah.
It's crazy. Well, let me say this, though, right? I mean, they could make a big chunk of that back because now they own the X-Men, right, as a property?
Yeah. It's good news, I think, for geekdom.
$71 billion?
$71.3
billion, yeah. What? Nobody has that money sitting around. Not even Disney.
How do you justify it? I mean,
you're
crazy,
sure right? It's not like
71.3. Single
that is insane.
That's got to be a, like over so many years. Because where do you come up with billions of dollars?
Yeah, and sometimes there's shares, right? Shares get exchanged and all that sort of thing. So it's basically a big chunk of change going into Rupert Murdoch's.
There's
pocket.
Only a handful of countries on the planet that you couldn't buy with that money. Holy cow!
Yeah, but it does have it has amazing implications, right, for the world of geekdom. Like we. Have thought all this time we're living in the golden age, right? Like you could not possibly have more of your childhood fantasies having huge amounts of money thrown at them and movies made.
Right.
And there's been this little corner of the universe that they didn't have access to. And now suddenly they got the keys now. So, we could have another whole level to this.
Yeah.
And 2 years from now I'd be saying, man, this is crazy. I didn't think it could get any better.
So quick poll then, are they going to Marvel it or are they gonna Star Wars it?
I hope that they go to Feig right away.
Before we give this to somebody else to screw it up, can you take the,
I guess it depends really.
Because we don't want people to get fatigue.
Right? I would say this. If Disney was smart, they would try to tempt if their plan is like we're gonna reboot X-Men and maybe does I think Fox owns or Sony. Who owns Fantastic Four? I think that's Fox
Sony.
Too. Sony?
Mm-hmm.
So Sony owns Spider-Man and Fantastic Four.
Yep.
So they don't have rights to the Fantastic Four. It's just X-Men. So if they just said, hey, we're gonna Marvel this X-Men. We're gonna X-Men it up. Mm-hmm. The Marvelous X guys. We're gonna get them. And if they were to lure Feige back into his job with that universe, I think it'd be great. I will say this. Anybody else, if it's not Feige, I think you gotta go in real skeptical.
Yeah.
I think you got to say
absolutely.
Yeah.
I'm excited, though, because I just...
Oh, I stand corrected. It says Sony and Fox has owned X-Men and Fantastic Four. I stand corrected.
Oh, so we could get some good Fantastic Four.
Right after I sent it to you, I was like, wait a second.
So really,
that would be exciting to get some good Fantastic Four movies.
Sony's the last one that needs to kind of give in to this monopolization that Disney's doing.
Like, they sort of have, right? They pay for the movie to get made.
It's almost like one of those real estate deals. Like, you wait to be the last person in the neighborhood to sell so that the big business is willing to overpay ridiculous for you. But if you wait too long, they're willing to build it around you and watch your property rot on the vine. You know what I'm saying? So, like, they're going to be playing that game. Who knows?
Yeah, it could be a few years from now. Where, like, Sony sold Spider-Man for $2 million. cried all the way to the bank.
But the ace they have up their sleeve is Marvel's completely unwilling to let Spider-Man blow. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Like, they love Spider-Man. It's like Disney's not going to allow Mickey Mouse be lame. You know what I'm saying? Like, Mickey Mouse is their thing. So hopefully it'll work. Yeah. So that is cool. I'm glad that has more money than I can wrap my head around, though. That's crazy sauce.
It's insane.
It's insane. Yeah, that's an incredible amount of money.
Okay, but can I? I've always felt that it was like, you know, it's a misuse of the word, but serendipitous that Marvel didn't have access to X-Men because for my druthers, I prefer X-Men to be separate from all the other Marvel stuff.
I don't necessarily want them in the same universe. That's for sure.
Yeah.
I don't think they would do that either. Fantastic Four is somewhat of a question, but
I like when they are separate, but I like that occasionally they could do like, hey, we'll do this movie and now we can include an Avenger or an X-Men where it fits, where it's cool, where, like, if they did some specific storyline that Marvel has done where there is a little bit of crossover, and if they go to make the movie about it, and like, well, what are they going to do? There's supposed to be an Avenger that shows up that plays a key role in this story arc that they're going to tell, and now what are they going to do? And now they don't have to worry about that.
Well, I hope, I can't decide in my brain if they're going to have like a crossover. Do they just, like, if they need to have, you know, Wolverine show up in an Avengers story, do they just throw Hugh Jackman out there, or do they have, like, in the Avengers world, this is the Wolverine, but in the X-Men world, actor number two is Wolverine, and it's different universe.
They've
Wolverine.
Sort of been doing that, right? Because Scarlet Witch and Quicksilver have been Marvel world Scarlet Witch and Quicksilver, but when if you go to the X-Men movies, Quicksilver was a
different
guy,
right? Because the Quicksilver, sort of I don't recall seeing Scarlet Witch in any.
I don't think they used.
Anyways, Scarlet Witch, but the Quicksilver, and see, I prefer that because, like, the Marvel.
When there's tie-in. Now I like that they could tie it in.
It makes me nervous just because the whole X-Men storyline being like the whole like social thing is a huge part, an essential part of their story. But I want that storyline to just be in that. I don't want that to bleed into that story arc. It's just too much. For me,
I just like I think there's an awesome X-Men line called it's several story arcs, like Messiah Complex and Second Coming and all of these things that have to do with very terrible, terrible things happening to the entire X-Men mutant community, I'll say. But I love the storyline because it is so it's very like Dark Knight and Mission Impossible Fallout. It's very like stressful and tense, and we are losing, and if we are winning, it is barely, like, it is until the end. It is like, well, what's going down here? Like, that,
what's the storyline?
It's several story arcs. It's part of it's called Messiah Complex, part of it's called Second Coming, part of it's called I think there's another one.
Mostly
in
Cable stuff.
It's all the Cable and Hope. It's all the Cable and Hope
you
stuff.
Call them out and hit them,
but it has to do with the entire this is better because it has to do with the entire mutant community, which is awesome. But the Avengers do show up in it at some point to help them out. And so I think if they were to do that cinematically, first of all, I would love that.
And then they realize, thank goodness, Spider-Man, Captain America, Hulk, Thor, and Iron Man
and Thor
show awesome.
Up to help out in Captain America, and they're doing something. And so it'd be just kind of cool to have.
Speaking of Cable, Deadpool is also getting pulled in with that, right?
Isn't that? Yeah, he's Fox owns him, right? Yep. Yeah, so Deadpool.
And as we've discussed before,
we're going to see PG-13 Deadpool.
The desire is really to kind of like tug Cable over to a more sort of the altruistic Cable that we know. Have a totally weird scene where he's fighting Thanos and it's me.
Yeah.
Okay, Thanos.
I'm getting paid double for this, right?
Seems really dark. Are you sure you don't belong in the DC universe?
Yeah. That's like my go-to line now. If I'm on the internet and somebody comments something that's like a little mean or whatever like that, first comment, so dark, are you sure you're not from the DC universe? Works every time. In the other wings of the Disney world, did you guys see the Star Wars Resistance trailer, the animated series?
Yes.
Yes, I did.
Thoughts, opinions, Poe Dameron, BB-8, fighter pilots?
You know what? I feel like I'm always the guy that poops on stuff, and I'm going to poop on something right now. I am not impressed. No Jedis. Mm. I don't want to watch something where there's no Jedis, episode 8.
Oh! Shots have been fired.
It was his turn. I was fatigue man, and now he got... Yeah, yeah. Okay.
It's true. They didn't show any. The interesting thing is that the other half of this, right, is them bringing Clone Wars back, and they went out of their way to show Jedis in that one. So they're kind of like, hey, if Jedis are your thing, you got this, and if not, you got this. And I've heard two differing opinions. I don't know if you guys have heard one way or the other. I heard one person say Filoni is just kind of like a distant executive producer. He's not directly involved. And then I've heard other stuff say, no, this is his baby. He is directly involved in the writing and the crafting of it. Which is a key thing, because he did Clone Wars.
Yeah, I mean, he gets a lot of credit for Clone Wars success. Yeah.
Huh. So, that would be my preference, was if he was heavily involved. But
to me, it felt like a kid's variety show, almost like the Mickey Mouse Club TV shows that I would see.
Oh, yeah?
It felt very little kiddie, like silly, like a lot of silliness.
The opening theme was like Star Wars. Star Wars. If you don't have kids, that is the Mickey Mouse Clubhouse.
Yeah, yes. So I was going to have a less than excited response, but I don't want to steal somebody's thunder over here. I like when he does it. We can call him the guy instead.
No, you can give your
retain your title, Negative Nancy.
Yeah. Stun Silence Bobblehead Man, or what was it again?
Yeah,
I prefer Norman. That's not MML. Yeah. Negative Norman.
So, jury's out for me. I don't know. I got a slight anime vibe from it. I don't know if you guys picked it
yeah,
a little bit.
Like kind of that.
A little bit.
Yes.
Not a lot,
yes.
But a little bit.
I mean, I'm sure I'll give it a try. I'm the open. Kids love the I would anime. Love for it to be awesome. I mean, that's my idea. I want it all to be awesome. Yeah. Another thing to do and to enjoy, right? So, I'm rooting for it to be awesome.
I want Darth Maul to be in the end of every other episode inexplicably. Like, why is he here? He didn't even do anything. Like, just for the camera to pan over.
Just as a holographic phone call. Just,
Even like, it's just him like getting a drink of something. And he's like, what? Like, like it's just like, okay, they're starting small. Yeah.
They should just, why don't they have him bring him back in, you know, episode 9? I mean, he's only died twice.
Oh, that's right. He did die twice. Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, why not just bring him? I mean,
cats have 9 lives, right? Maybe part his race is part feline. So...
Well, instead of ending on a negative note, I got
that's
one other thing.
That's my favorite note, though. That's my favorite. All right, sorry, go ahead. Sorry.
Positive note.
Okay.
And then I'll shut up and you guys can talk. But I found out today that there is a movie being made called Holmes and Watson. You ready for this? You couldn't dream of a better pair. Will Ferrell and John C. Reilly.
Oh. Really? Oh my gosh. Please
How
tell me.
How great is that going to be?
Oh, but it's going to be rated R with a hard R, probably, right?
Well, I guess I don't know. There wasn't any details.
Okay, tell me the setting. Is it Victorian England or is it modern?
Yeah.
Oh my
they
gosh.
They were in full regalia, if you will. I was so excited when I saw that.
Oh my gosh.
You can see.
My initial reaction is excitement, but I worry it's going to be super crass and I don't like that. And then I won't be able to watch it. But if they could keep it in the.
Just for the trailers, I want to see.
Yeah, just for the trailers. Yeah.
I just want to. I'm glad they're making it so I can see trailers of it.
Oh man.
I love John C. Reilly. Yeah.
He is funny.
He's a good actor. And who doesn't like Wolf?
But I heard they actually. It's funny because I figured you'd do it because I think I heard that they're actually going to make another Sherlock Holmes Robert Downey Jr. movie.
So, oh really?
They've been teasing one for a while, and man, would I love it! I love that franchise.
Have them both open on the same
so
weekend.
Much.
That would be funny.
Give
right?
you the option one way or the other.
Right.
One that takes it serious. One takes it really serious.
I would be torn. I'm not gonna lie.
I want to look up and see how long is it since the last Sherlock Holmes movie? Because
it's been a long time.
If it's been long enough, if we're talking in the 6 to 8 year range, there will be children that go see that movie that say, "Hey, that's Iron Man."
Yeah. Where's the suit?
The first two with Jude Law and Robert Downey Jr. So good.
They're so good, yeah.
So good.
I still loved it. And it's not, he didn't invent the phrase or anything like that, but when I say it, the picture in my head is the scene from the second one when he's riding the pony with all the horses. He's slow and steady wins the race. Yeah.
He's riding a little pony.
Riding little ponies.
Because he doesn't like, because Sherlock horses. Doesn't like riding horses. Yeah. They're dangerous at both ends and crafty in the middle.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
That was the movie that brought the world Mark Strong as well. He played the bad guy in the first one.
Yes.
The bald guy.
Yes.
He had a slight snaggle tooth. Yeah. That was the first time I sort of like saw him and kind of took note. And it seems like in the years since, he has just, his career's taken off. So
yeah. And that's when I realized I love Guy Ritchie's way of telling a story. I absolutely love it. And it fits so brilliantly with the Sherlock Holmes stories.
Yeah. Well, that's enough about me. What about you, Bobblehead?
What you got in your inbox there, Saxablin?
Well, I thought we could take a second.
Complain more about the last Jedi?
We talked about the inbox, which I felt like was very fitting. Because I want to do some letters from the Hero Escape Podcast mailbag.
Oh, it's about time. Yeah, let's set it up.
A legitimate bag that we brought in here.
Man, thank I feel like you, we need a intern. Jingle to go with this or something.
Mailbag. Okay, so I'm going to read some of the letters. If you guys have any
questions,
that's fine with everybody. Is that fine with listeners? You said okay? Okay, cool. Okay, so, this first question, have we ever dropped that we work on computers a little bit? Because someone asked, what frames per second will I get on this laptop? I will tell you nothing about. I don't know. I don't know what frames. I don't know. It depends.
12.
12, I guess. Okay. The next letter says Fortnite. Spelled like the video game. So I guess there's a Fortnite video game, everybody.
Yep. My kids love it.
Breaking news.
It was a big deal on the Twitch streaming app. I'm sure everybody's familiar with the Twitch streaming app, right?
Yeah.
It was a huge deal when for a brief several-hour period, it wasn't even a whole day, for a brief several-hour period, World of Warcraft unseated Fortnite as number one in the number of viewers on Twitch. Yeah. So unseated that tells you how popular Fortnite is.
I actually read this on the internet. Someone's writing in about it.
My son had a friendly tournament of Fortnite at our house with his friends. Really? Yes, that game has exploded.
Friendly?
They were all rooting for each other, although trying to kill each other too, I guess.
So in the movie Black Panther, when T'Challa strikes the new Panther suit, do you remember that? The one that's...
That absorbs the energy and
Blasts
it back out.
To test its kinetic energy storage, some glowing Wakandan text appears on the torso. If you translate this chunk of text, and I Googled this because I read this earlier and saw it on the internet, there is a translation guide for the Wakandan characters. It says, I love you, Mom.
Really?
Are you serious?
That's real. Yeah. That's awesome, right?
Huh. And I do love you, Mom.
Yeah.
I love you, Mom. Okay.
That's not really what I expected
and
to be honest.
And so does whoever.
Yeah. I'm glad it was that. I'm very glad that was that.
And so does...
It'd be like, I'm Marvel rich now, suckers. Or something like that. Yeah.
I'm Marvel rich. Take this, DC.
Who's your Batman now?
Yeah.
Mr. Warming Up. Next letter.
Okay. Is there such a thing as type 3 diabetes? I don't know I don't know why.
I'm a dentist, not a doctor. I don't do research.
If it's
on
a reduction scale, right, and like one is the worst and two is, then type 3, I think pretty much every single American has. That's what we can
So do. I read the opposite. I read that.
State.
I read, here's what I.
Sodas that. And milkshake and.
So cookies. I don't know the answer, but my thoughts are that it's actually called super diabetes or. Los glucos loco. Okay.
So trademark pending. All right. Trademark pending.
Super diabetes. Los glucos loco.
That's going to be your name next week.
I feel like that you could see that on a Taco Bell menu sometime soon, too. Los glucos loco at your Taco Bell.
If that happens, I will start looking for pigs flying, and I will call you master for at least a week. All right. Continue.
What do you guys think makes a good tongue twister? Well, it's hard to say.
Oh.
That one's me. I slipped that one in there.
Are you sending in your own messages to our mailbag again?
Okay, this is kind of a
about this bobblehead.
Personal question. Somebody's interested in what we look like, and specifically, like, how do you guys dress? What are you wearing? So I'm going to describe what...
Well, Mr. Bobblehead is wearing a delightful negligee that is... Very formal.
Right. Formal.
Formal.
Black tie.
Yeah. Mm. Sorry.
Well, Mr. Take Me Downa is, I would describe what he's wearing as over halves, maybe. Sort of like overalls that stop at the waist.
Yeah.
And then like two.
You got to cover the navel, otherwise it's embarrassing.
Two thirds of a pair of pants. I don't know. It's weird. Google Final Fantasy video game. And then
that's a pretty apt description.
That's how he's dressed.
Of his outfit right now.
Naturally.
And then Mr. Social Justice something.
Misfire.
Mr. Misfire. Is wearing a Shakespearean collar while being dressed like a samurai. So
it's kind of a regular day for him.
Yeah, regular day for him. I'm not saying this is no costumery here.
Yeah.
No costumery or...
Comfort is the primary thing.
Yeah. Really. Your samurai robes with your Shakespearean
collar. Every day is casual Friday here.
Dashing.
For us. Yeah.
That's right.
All right. That's right. All right. We're about to wrap it up here. Do you guys know what R2-D2 is saying when he's doing his beeps and boops? Do you guys any idea what he's saying?
No, dude, it's because it's a kid's movie, dude. They gotta beep it out.
I say, R2, yes, salty language.
So I Googled and I could only find one. And it's in episode 4, when the first time you see him, and it says they're running from the stormtroopers on the...
Tantivore.
Yeah, that's it. He says, they seem to be concentrating all their fire on the walls and ceiling, so if we stick to the floor, we should be okay.
He's a smart robot.
He picks out those laser trajectories.
Yeah.
I got to start turning the closed captioning on more often.
Yeah.
And this one's another kind of like the Black Panther one earlier. He wants to point out something, which I think is awesome. In Rogue One, A Star Wars Story, which is a great movie if you haven't seen it.
Pretty good.
The best.
Chirrut's walking stick has a light on the end of it.
Chirrut is the blind guy, right?
He's the blind guy. Yeah. But his walking stick has a light on the end of it. This is to help him see in the dark.
Are you implying he was faking the whole time? Is that what was going on?
I'm not implying anything.
Not really blind?
I'm just telling you, Chirrut Imwe.
Unless you're blind, you cannot purposely talk about this, okay?
Purposely set himself a weapon that is also a walking stick and put a light on the end of it.
I'm a fake blind guy.
Maybe it's to grab the attention of those who are not visually impaired, so it's distracting them while he whacks them with the other end.
Anyway, that is the HeroScape Pod mailbag. I hope you all enjoyed it. Yeah. Guys, keep writing us your letters. Don't ask us any more medical questions.
We don't want to get ones like that wrong.
That's what I wanted to share.
Okay.
What have you been up to, Mr. Take Me Downa?
Take Me Downa? Okay, so... let me just tell you, there's nothing more important in life than family, right? So vacation, spent some time with my family. One thing my wife and children know about me is that I have a deserved but yet still irrational fear of the ocean and the vicious beasts that live there solely with the desire to eat me.
Oh, yeah. Yep. Dolphins. Terrifying.
Okay. So
I'm moved here from Florida.
And so that most of the beasts there, they're looking to eat me.
Yeah,
they're,
and I knew your name before I moved here because I would hear like, we're going to eat that guy in Texas, yeah. Take me down a peg. Yeah. We're going to eat him. If you see him, tell him we're coming for him.
Yeah. So it's both rational and irrational because I understand that it's irrational and I'll explain that part, but I have almost drowned. I am I know how to swim, swimmer, but I have almost drowned at least three depending on how you want to count on, maybe four times in my life. Okay. So I am
about
scared.
That bathtub incident.
It was okay. 2 inches is not the same as three. All right.
That's too many times, Dave.
If you had your water wings on like normal.
Yeah. Right. So what movie does my wife want to go see on date night the other day? Meg. So
yes,
my sweet angelic wife. That is my number one adjective for my wife. She is an angel. She decides, let's go see Meg. And what does my stupid male ego say to do? Well, I'm not going to let her think I'm too afraid to go watch that movie. So I go and watch it with her.
Can I ask you real quick, though?
Yeah. Did
for a second in like part of your mind or heart, whichever part was most...
My heart rate is tripled since starting this conversation.
Did you think for a second, like, I really want to tell her that I'm afraid to go see that movie? Did you think that for a second?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I did. I'm like, okay. I'm going to like freak out. She's like, oh, it'll be fine. I'm like, okay. I mean, if you want to watch it, we're going to watch it. Like, we had that, I was, stiff upper lip and all that.
Yeah.
Okay. And so we go watch this movie. And, okay, for the almost now 2 decades that we've been married, my wife's wanted to eventually go on a cruise someday. And I'm like, I am terrified. The thought of being out in the ocean freaks me out.
Even on a huge boat like that, huge ship.
Freaks me out. Just to know, like if I'm on the ship and I don't see the ocean and you don't tell me I'm in the ocean, I can imagine it. But just thinking about myself on it. Okay. I've gotten close to the point where, as a surprise, maybe I was going to get some tickets. Let me just tell you, after watching the Meg, that is not going to happen. So, part of
You tell her something like, you sunk that ship yourself.
I did. On the way out of
use that pun on purpose.
On the way out of the theater, I'm like, I have been self, you know, psychosis trying to heal that so that I could fulfill one of your bucket list things to go on a cruise somewhere nice. And that all just went flush down the toilet watching this movie. So I'm watching this movie and it's reminding me that I watched Jaws on TV at way too young of an age. Okay. And, it's a well-made movie, by the way. I do recommend going see it. For me.
Oh yeah. This is a glowing recommendation. Yeah.
I love Jaws, right? I love that.
Dark phobia.
We're going to need another boat.
Yeah.
That famous quote.
Yeah, right. That
the
was
the famous quote.
Bigger. The Meg is bigger than the great white shark of Jaws. And so it's a well-made movie. The casting is great. John's, I can't ever say his last name right. Statham, however you say his name.
Jason,
sorry. He's great in it. The story, the effects, it's a good movie. It's a well-made movie. Go watch it. We had that row in the theater where there was no chairs in front of me. It was like a railing and
you're just kicking it.
Dude, if there had been a person sitting in front of me, I probably would have either he would have been knocked out or he would have turned around and knocked me out because I was like, legs flying out like so many times. I can't even, and then, so they release Meg as a marketing genius. Meg gets released as we've all, it was Shark Week, right? Discovery Channel with all the sharks. There's a bazillion things. So I come home and throughout the week now, I come home from work and almost without fail, my sweet family and angelic wife are watching some sort of shark TV show, Jaws 2, 3, 4, whatever. And I'm like, you are not helping. So you have an addiction, I have an affliction, okay?
So wait. There's a little bit of a difference, I feel like, between like a fear of drowning, like, you know, being out in open water, and a fear of like dark water and the creatures that might be there. Is it both, or one of those two is more than the other?
You can't talk about both in the same sentence. What are you trying to, I'm going to pass out. No, it's both. I mean, why stop at one fear when you can have them all? Okay.
Well, I guess what I'm saying is, you know, you said that you've almost drowned a few times. It's understandable then to have a fear of open water. You know, you don't have any kind of whatever, but doesn't necessarily link up with sharks unless you're thinking like, okay, it's gonna pull me under or, you know, whatever. Like, I assume the Meg was less about people drowning, right? And more about people getting attacked.
Yes.
So it's, I don't know. I'm just curious about where the line is here,
they were in deep water and it was dark and it was all of the above. I mean, that's what I'm saying. It was well made because it hit all of those fears that everybody has a little bit of, right? I mean, there's like a healthy survival instinct to stay away from things with a mouth bigger than your body. You know what I'm saying? Like that's the survival instinct I think most people have.
And, well, I'm not too worried about it since Megs don't exist, but.
Okay. Well, you should be.
So what you're saying is...
No, it was on the movie. I saw it. Okay?
That is true.
It's there.
Okay. Can't dispute the film.
On the screen.
So you're equally terrified whether you're watching The Exorcist or Titanic. That's what you're saying.
No, I'd be less scared watching some demon movie than I would ever be. A movie where it makes me imagine what it would be like in the middle of the ocean with nothing but darkness underneath me.
Jack!
That is more terrifying.
Jack!
So, anyways...
I feel like I got to bring something up.
Go for it.
Something came to my attention this week. Kind of ruined my week, to be honest. It was hard to deal with. Not unlike your shark situation. Someone who is at this table right now brought to my attention that a movie that I had previously scored in an honest and transparent manner, based on the data that was available to me, did in fact contain a secret Matt Damon cameo. Deadpool 2.
What?
There is apparently the scene where there's two rednecks talking at the back of the truck. One of them was him in like 4 hours of like prosthetic makeup. Ergo, I didn't recognize him. Therefore, I did not dock at the point.
I was reading his Twitter. He did it just to hide from you. He's like, I've heard this Hero Escape podcast guy hates me.
I knew.
I'll show him what for.
Mm-hmm. Well, I got news for you, Matt Damon. I am retroactively docking that point one. So your score has just dropped.
Do you remember your score?
Can you do that? Because he wasn't really there for you. I mean, if you don't know it's him, if a tree falls in the woods and nobody hears it, does it really make a noise? I mean, come on.
I think you do it.
Over and over and over again in my heart.
I think you should dock 2/10 of a point now for some sneaking and sneaky
stuff. Yes, subversive action. That's right. So, that was my week ruined. How about those sharks?
I seriously am trying to, I gotta get my heart rate down just talking about that. So just to tie into the irrational part, like I'm actually strong. I know how to swim. I'm a good swimmer, but, like last year we went on a trip to Cancun and the family wanted to go snorkeling. I'm like, yeah, let's go do snorkeling. It'll be great. It's so beautiful.
Really?
And cause I told you I had gotten really far in getting over my freaked outness part of it. Okay. Uh-huh. And I'm all about facing my fears. I almost drowned whitewater rafting and I still went back on the boat the next day to go and do it to overcome it. So I'm all about facing it. Like I don't want fear to rule sure. me. Right. But right. I am still abjectly terrified of it. So anyway, and I totally enjoyed the experience. The snorkeling experience. I found a big conch shell. It was super cool. There were no sharks.
that you know of.
Vastly helped the enjoyment. Okay. Coming out of that theater, talking to my wife and how I was like, why did you bring me to watch this movie? Just thinking and describing and remembering how I had a pleasant experience snorkeling freaks me out. I did it. I had a positive experience and remembering that positive freaks me out. Wow. That's how the irrational part.
I'm going to say something to you that may stick in your brain forever and may.
No. Are you unkind? Okay, unkind, sir.
Again, come from a beach surrounded state with oceans around it. So let me tell you something. When you're enjoying the water and you're like, there's no sharks out here.
Oh my gosh.
There are sharks out there. Every summer almost, the news flies over the beach. Showing all the tourists enjoying the water, thinking, I'm safe. And they always show, look at the sharks swimming 10 feet from these people that are completely oblivious like that. They always are like, look at all the sharks going
Unbelievable.
By.
Unbelievable.
It's awesome. As a Florida resident to see
I
that.
I absolutely hate you right now, David Saxon. You're a terrible person.
I try.
This has been your session on Hero Escape Therapy, where we take your childhood phobias and make them worse.
Let's see if we can't deepen that fear.
You know, friends like you
really.
Who need enemy guys. Right. Okay.
Let's see if we can't take that mild fear that you have that only creeps up in certain circumstances and turn it into a crippling
phobia.
Crippling phobia that makes you useless almost all the time.
Awesome.
I can't even...
Awesome.
So,
are you okay in lakes?
I have no dignity now. Yes and no. Like, I'll do it.
But a lake is not going to have a shark. I mean, the freshwater megalodon does not
exist. If I'm stupid enough to be in the water and look down and only see darkness or seaweed, I'll get freaked out.
I'll
keep swimming. I'm not going to like panic and then drown like an idiot, but it will freak me out.
Yeah.
I get more nervous in lakes and ponds than I do the ocean because of alligators. Because
it's snapping turtles for me.
Snapping turtles. I'm never worried about that, I guess. Not that they're not dangerous, but...
The lakes up north that I've been in obviously would not have had alligators. But then when I was growing up, and it was always like, oh my goodness, so-and-so saw this massive snapper crawl out of the lake the other day. Really? And you're going to be there for 5 days swimming.
So again, I feel like I've mentioned Florida like 50 times, but the rule in Florida is every body of water, no matter how small...
You assume there's a gator.
And they usually is. I moved into a neighborhood. Mm-hmm. They made every neighborhood in Florida, they dig a big pond. So that the water drains into because it rains so much in Florida.
Yeah.
And we built the house in the neighborhood. It was pretty new and the pond was very new. Mm. Very quickly, there's an alligator or two in the pond. They just like, oh, there's new water over there. Let's go and move into this pond. Boom. And that guy had to come out and catch it. But I just like, if I see one alligator, it doesn't matter how many times I see an alligator get pulled out or caught, I assume there's still one in there.
It never fails. You build a nice neighborhood, you put in a very stringent HOA, and you still can't keep the riffraff out. Unbelievable.
The part of me that likes nature in a way likes seeing alligator. I think, oh, that's cool, an alligator. But then I'm like, well, I also have a young child. So
yeah. I also have a young child. So I'm actively pursuing personal therapy. It's all self-induced therapy and psychosis. So maybe it's all my own problem and in my own head. But anyways.
So we've mostly caught up. But I feel like we need like 5 minutes because you were gone. After Mission Impossible Fallout. What did you think of Mission Impossible Fallout?
Oh, well, thanks. I thought it was a thoroughly entertaining movie.
Did the mustache live up to your expectations? That's what we really want to know.
Can we just cut to the chase and say Henry Cavill, he grows a mean mustache. I mean, that guy, he looks good. I mean, it's right up there with Tom Selleck. I mean, come on. He's a good looking dude.
Oh, high praise. Yeah.
Whoa. We need to have a mustache off sometime here.
Oh,
Yeah. Cinema and TV's greatest mustaches.
So, man, edge of your seat, heart pumping in a way very different than Megalodon, but my heart was pumping. Action was good.
Bathroom fight scene?
So, okay.
Not what you expect, right?
So here's my thing. Lots of surprises. I love to be surprised in movies. I love when old cliched ways of storytelling and character inducing are not used, when you find some new way to accomplish something. That's good. And I feel like a hypocrite because, and I think I've even said it to you guys before, one of the easiest ways to introduce a new baddie and say that he's really powerful is you have him walk into the room and throw a punch at the Hulk or the heavy in the room, or Thor or whatever, and right. Put him on his butt.
Yeah.
Right. Oh, this guy is not to be trifled with. He's powerful.
Not
right?
Unlike the beginning of Infinity War.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. So it's done all the time. It's in books all the time. That's done to the point where it's like, has Hulk or Thor ever learned how to dodge or block instead of taking that hit? But anyways, so in the bathroom scene, so watching the trailer, I was thinking, remember, I even said in our preview, like, I want to see Henry Cavill just man punch somebody. Right. Yeah, I was like so excited for that. And in the bathroom scene, it's a plot twist because you don't really find this out till later that the guy that they are coming to get is a paid assassin who knows he's showing up where people are going to try and, dangerous. Yeah, so he's like, really the trip was kind of on them. So he's prepared for it. And this Asian guy beats the tar out of Cavill and Cruz.
That's what I said, right? They were lucky they got out of the bathroom alive. Like, that right? Dude was...
Yeah.
So I love that it was a surprise, and they didn't... But the character that was being introduced, really, in that sequence, and the previous couple of minutes, was the Henry Cavill, who's introduced as the number one plumber, meaning assassin, for the CIA. And he has to get his life saved by Tom Cruise, then gets his butt kicked by an Asian guy, right?
Yeah.
So I mean, he gets some nasty punches in, which the Asian, but the guy still beats up the Asian guy who dies. Spoiler alert. Sorry.
It's all good.
Beats the tar out of the unassailable Ethan Hunt, Tom Cruise, and the Henry Cavill, Walker Texas Ranger, like you guys said in your episode. He beats the crap out of both of them, right?
Yeah.
So
you felt like it was like downgrading him.
It kind of did. Making
more ominous.
I have a terrible memory, but I think I talked about that I was like, I feel like the trailer tried to show, like, look at this guy is going to seriously jack someone up. Look at him right here. We're showing you. He right there. He reloads his fists.
And so I never got that. Like, they should have just, if they just put in like, so I'm like, this is me being retarded. So like, I love that they didn't do it was the old way. Everybody does it this way. He's bad. Easy. They're going to show him just clean the clock of somebody that Ethan Hunt couldn't do. So if they did that, it was fine, but they needed to reestablish Henry Cavill, and even to maybe, I mean, Ethan Hunt's got five or six movies now to show that he is a tough guy and gritty and all that stuff. So maybe they didn't need to reestablish it with him. But really, until the end, you don't think like you're getting the two aces on a good and a bad ace fighting each other. It's almost like.
I felt like with Ethan Hunt, they did. I mean, they showed him when he escorts the White Widow, or what's her name?
Oh, yeah.
He takes down all those dudes.
Yeah. Well, she took has out the some awesome, too, which
she,
is
she,
yeah.
She helped.
So they're
he,
cool.
He was the main dude.
Yeah. So they don't necessarily. That's what I'm saying.
His awesome plan to get Solomon Lane was incredible.
Yeah. They didn't necessarily need to reestablish him as being awesome because we know. He's still being played by Tom Cruise.
Yeah.
Anyways,
Tom Cruise.
Right. But the Henry Cavill character is new, and then they didn't ever really show him break someone for me.
My one grievance. I loved the movie.
Yeah, me too.
I love it. I felt like they needed one scene, and I'd be curious to see if there's a deleted scene.
Guys, are you totally forgetting about the time where he totally laid out Alec Baldwin? I mean, come on. Like, that was just like a major two titans.
Yeah, you're right.
That's going at it.
The 50-year-old
underground replacement guy.
So score out of 10.
Can I just finish my...
No. Stop.
I think you're getting to this. They needed a scene to show that he is... that he is the guy that they hired. I feel I think I said this in the podcast. They intentionally hired an actor. I feel like not just based on that he played Superman in movies. They hired a big guy.
Yeah.
He's a big man.
Yeah.
Which and they need dwarfs Tom Cruise in size. Like they had to keep putting Tom Cruise in perspective or on something taller to not have him like
so super dwarf him. But I feel like you got to give him a scene that shows that. We hired a big muscly dude and he needs to punch someone
hard.
The crap out. Right. Yeah. He needs to hit someone so hard they just go down. Like that.
Yeah.
And I want to, that's what I want to see.
So that's my, so I've spent all this time to do this one little grip. I totally enjoyed the movie. It was really good. I even watched it again with you after, Mr. Bobblehead, after I had already seen it the one time.
Yeah. And I watched it again with me too.
You did?
And you.
Yeah. Okay. And, like it just bugged me more than I thought it would because if they had just, can I just, if they had just, even if they didn't establish it, like where he crushes the Asian assassin guy, if he, at the end, just like a scene or two where, like when he's fighting Tom, Ethan Hunt at the end, where he's getting some of those gut punches in, if they had just like, boom, and did like a slow-mo, or you heard like a crack, cause later he's talking about my ribs, yeah. Right? I mean, he should have died like a million times over all the crashes and stuff, like every movie is like that, but if they just like, boom, 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 so it felt like, you know, and like he was the power, like just to justify, just something like that would have been so much more. But they got, they had to dirty him up instead. They had to ruin his beautiful face.
All that money to keep that mustache, and then just they melted
his face off, right?
So I feel like they should have thrown in one more like red shirt, you know, Star Trek lingo, the red shirt, expendable, Mission Impossible guy that he just let him, just let him just pound away on that or something. There should have been a scene where to show him just. Yeah. Devastate somebody physically.
So to make a villain, one of the ways you make a villain tower is either he's so brutally heartless that it terrifies you, or powerful and, you know, like some crushing way, just so destructive that you're terrified of him. And I just wish they had strengthened either one of those. The other bad guy, whatever his crazy name, did you ever choose not to? Where that guy? Solomon. He's so like messed up. You're terrified.
He's already that. Psycho.
Yeah. So, I wish they did. Anyways, you cannot go lower than an 8 for this movie, or you don't have a brain, and I don't respect you. So, it was a very, very good movie. Like my first time I watched, I'm like thinking it's a 9. That thing just it bugged me so much.
Below a 9 now? Is that what we're saying?
I'm thinking like a high 8. Yeah, high
go 9 because like that movie keeps my like. Tension level, like it keeps it like pegged, like it's high up there.
Yeah,
like I'm redlined throughout the movie, so I'm like, you know.
Both my boys went to go see it. My teenage boys, they went and go saw it. That is the most tense movie I've ever seen in my entire life, Dad. Like it's so good.
When you described it as the Dark Knight to me, and I was like, what?
But that's what I was saying.
Like you're movie that when it's over, I'm like,
you're exhausted. Yeah. That's what I was trying to say.
We got through it, Ethan Hunt. We did it together.
Yeah. So, but having watched it twice, am I going to, my ability to want to watch it again and again and again, I think waned. Having seen it again, I'm like, I definitely, no ways is it lower than an 8 ever. So I totally enjoyed it. It's a good movie.
You got to admit though, I mean, no Matt Damon. So
it helps, right? It helps.
It's a big deal.
What if we find out that like some dude?
No, no, don't say it.
You know what it is? Here it is. What bothered you about the guy giving him the mission? That's Matt Damon's voice disguised.
Oh my god.
The guy that's giving him the, you know, the
your mission, apostles. Should you choose to accept it.
You're like, oh, that's why that's Matt Damon's voice, but he's disguised, so why would they hire him?
No, they just had this sense.
Forgive me to go going back to the Deadpool thing, but why was it so important to put him in the movie and then not let anyone know he was in it? Like, I don't even, like, it's so bizarre.
It almost feels like Matt Damon wants to be in every superhero movie.
Yeah.
But he can't be for some, like, it can't be Matt Damon.
So, like, why
he has to be in disguise?
Because
like,
no one would
catch. He's in his Loki. He's in his redneck. I mean, is it like because people are like, look, you're Matt Damon. We can't, everybody's just going to watch
Matt Damon. It's going to pull focus. Yeah, right? Or
we'll I think he, in. Behind the scenes, he does have a cameo campaign going on. That's the mission.
You think he
the
has mission a cameo is
to
campaign?
Ruin as many movies as possible with cameos.
He's here's what he's doing. He's walking down. I wish we had like a microphone effect so I could really like act this out in here. But he's walking down the studio, the hallways of studios, right? Like, hey, what movie are you making? You got like a 5-minute part there I could do? Yeah. Cool. I'll be there. Like that. And walking out, just pokes his head in some other doorway. Hey, what movie are you making? Oh, Men in Black 5? I'll be in that quick. I'll just be an alien for like 5 seconds. Yeah. Okay. Cool.
You hear him whisper after he leaves. Just let him. Don't fight. It's not worth it.
Yeah.
It's easier to say yes than no. Trust me. Yeah. Well, okay.
On that note.
All right. Well, let's, are we going to?
I think we're all caught up.
Okay. All right.
Did everybody get everything off their chest that they had from our long summer hiatus?
I feel purged.
Good. I'm glad, Mr. Bubblehead. That's why we're here.
And I need therapy, so we're good. Yeah. Which you guys have not helped at all. Thank you.
My work here is done.
Well, thanks for listening to us, and we hope you enjoyed. We hope you guys had a great summer, too. You can find us, as usual, on heroescapepod.com, and we'll see you all the next week.
Peace out.